In this lecture, what we're going to do is take a population, which we assume has been modeled by some nice function p of t, and look at its derivative dp dt, the rate of change of the population with respect to time. To better understand how we model populations under the simple assumption that a population is closed. So we say a population is closed if it only changes due to births and deaths. There's no immigration or harvesting or anything like that. So what we're looking at here is the rate of change of a population with respect to time is the first derivative of the function p of t. So that's p prime of t, or if you like, you can denote that dp dt. And we compute that by taking the limit of a difference quotient. P of t plus a little change factor delta, so p of t plus delta minus p of t, divided by t plus delta minus t, which of course simplifies to just delta. So the numerator here is a change in outputs, and the denominator delta is the corresponding change in inputs. We're going to work with this difference quotient to figure out how to express how a population changes with respect to birth and death. Okay, so let's bring in some new notation. Let beta be the birth rate per population individual per unit of time. So the unit for beta is kind of strange because I have per individual per unit of time. So it's births per member of the population per unit of time. And then let mu represent the death rate per population individual per unit of time. So the unit here is similar. It's going to be the number of deaths per individual per unit of time. As we move forward, we'll talk a little bit more about what beta and mu have to look like, but keep in mind that they don't have to be fixed numbers. They could be. So beta could be a fixed rate like 0.1, but it could also be a function of time, and it could also be a function of the population. Perhaps the larger the population you have, the lower the birth rate. That's actually something that you can observe in a real population. So while these look almost like numbers, like fixed numbers, they could actually have a more interesting form. Okay, let's see how to incorporate beta and mu into our population model. I think it's really helpful here to keep track of the units because, as we saw, the units were a little bit complicated. So let's see what happens to our population as we go from time t to time t plus delta. How does it fluctuate? Well, we're going to add some number of babies. So how many babies are born during this time period? This is going to be an approximation because we're taking a step from t to t plus delta. Okay, so let's say the number of babies. Okay, so I'm going to write the birth rate together with its unit because we want to make sure that our units balance out here. It's beta babies per individual per unit time. Okay, so that's the birth rate. Then how many individuals do we have? Well, that's the size of the population at time t. So that's going to be times p of t total individuals times how much time goes by. So we're collecting babies over a certain amount of time, and that time is going to be t plus delta minus t, or in other words, delta. Delta units of time. So I'm writing time here, but it could be years or months or something like that. Okay, let's see how our units look. We have individuals canceling with individuals. So that's the number of members of the species present. And then time down here in the denominator cancels with this unit of time. So the only unit left here is babies. So this is going to estimate the number of babies born from time t to time t plus delta. So that's beta times p of t times delta. And then we do the same thing with mu. Instead of beta, we might have mu deaths per individual per unit of time times the number of individuals, that's the size of the population, P of t, and then times delta units of time. Okay, so overall we get individuals cancel, the units of time cancel, and we're left with mu times P of t times delta total deaths. I wrote equality here, but I really should have said that this is approximate, so these are estimates. And the reason why is we're treating the times t and t plus delta as discrete moments, whereas p of t and also beta, if beta depends on time and population, these change as we go from t to t plus delta. So P of t is not going to be constant during that whole interval. Everything changes as time moves forwards. But this is a pretty good estimate, and it's a really good estimate if delta is very small. So assuming that delta is suitably small, we can estimate the net change in the population from time t to time t plus delta, which we'll denote as the population at time t plus delta. This is approximately the population at time t plus the number of births minus the number of deaths. So that's going to be P of t plus beta P of t times delta minus mu P of t times delta. Okay, now I'm going to take P of t and subtract it to the left-hand side. So that's the new population minus the starting population. That's the net change in population. On the right-hand side, let me factor out delta from the remaining terms. And we'll have delta times beta times P of t minus mu times P of t. I can divide delta over to the left-hand side, and it's going to look like the difference quotient that we saw in the first slide. So we have the change in outputs, P of t plus delta minus P of t, divided by delta, and if you like, you can do t plus delta minus t just to see the change in inputs, is approximately equal to, and on the right-hand side, let me also factor P of t out of the remaining terms, and we'll have beta minus mu times P of t. This is an approximation, but in the limit, as delta goes down to zero, our calculation turns exact. And what we have is on the left-hand side, we're going to get P prime of t. And then on the right-hand side, just beta minus mu times P of t. Now this equation that we have here, P prime of t or dp dt equals the term beta minus mu times P of t. This is true for any nice closed population where, again, we don't have things like immigration or harvesting. So if all populations satisfy this differential equation relating the rate of change of the population to the size of the population, what distinguishes one from the other is the behavior of beta minus mu. So different scenarios might cause beta minus mu to look a little different. Okay, let's look at an example, and this is going to be our classic exponential growth model. So we've seen this equation before. P of t equals p naught e to the rt. Let's show that this growth model satisfies the following description. A population grows proportionally to its current size. So we'll translate that into words and then show that this model satisfies our mathematical description of this phrase. Then we'll recognize that that's the same thing as saying that term beta minus mu is a constant. So what we want to show is the rate of change of this population with respect to time, or dp dt, is proportional to its current size, which is P of t. So let's compute the first derivative. P naught is a constant. Then we have e to the rt, and we're differentiating with respect to t. So just from basic differentiation of an exponential function and the chain rule, what we're going to get is dp dt is going to be p naught e to the rt times r, which I'm going to write now as r p naught e to the rt. Notice p naught e to the rt is p of t itself. So I could also write this derivative as r times p of t. So overall, dp dt equals r p of t. This means dp dt and p of t are proportional to each other, and the constant of proportion is r. But if this population is closed, then we also know that dp dt equals beta minus mu times p of t. Comparing those two relationships, we see that beta minus mu must be the constant r. So this is another way to describe exponential growth. Okay, for our last example in this lecture, let's look at this population model. We haven't seen this equation before. So this is dp dt equals rp times 1 minus p over k. T is time in years. R and k are positive parameters, so those are constants. And we're assuming that this population is closed. So let's find an expression for beta minus mu, and then we'll interpret it. So since the population is closed, dp dt equals beta minus mu times p of t. Let's compare that expression to the formula that we have at the top. So what do we have in common? Let's see. If we know that this also has to be rp times 1 minus p over k, then we can compare. They both have p of t. So if I remove that from the left and right hand side, we're left with beta minus mu equals r times 1 minus p of t over k. That's a perfectly good form to put that in, but if you like, you could also think of this as negative r over k times p of t plus r. And that's a line. We can do that by treating the population like an independent variable and beta mu like a dependent variable, in which case this expression here is like the equation of a line. So in particular, if I try to graph this, where we're going to put p on the positive independent axis and beta minus mu on the dependent axis, when the population is zero, beta minus mu is the positive number r. So that's the y-intercept. And then the x-intercept is going to happen when the population is k. So the line that we can draw relating the population to the quantity beta minus mu is going to look like this. So what we can conclude from this picture is that if the population is between 0 and k, beta minus mu is positive. So we're going to be having a net increase in our population. However, if the population is larger than k, beta minus mu is negative, and we're going to be having a decrease. We will actually continue to look at this population model in the next lecture. Thank you for your attention.